If people are not listening to you, stop talking to them. And that is the best piece of advice that I can give you. And what happens is that if you stop talking to people who aren't listening to you and start watching them instead, they will tell you what they're up to. But so if you have things to say, say them, but you find people that will listen, talk to them. The ones who aren't listening, pull back. Because you're devaluing what you have to say by offering it to an audience that does nothing but reject it.
I never fucked anybody over in my life. Didn't have a car. All I have in this world is my balls and my word. And I don't break them for no one. You understand?
I already have, you know, a longer video to upload, but I wanted to address this very quick. Of course, this user is already blocked because he's misinforming people because it can't use Google. Instead, he's using his channel for, I don't know what the fuck that cowboy is doing with an nunchaku. And he says, atmospheric pressure doesn't change your blood pressure to any real degree unless it kills you. That's the dumbest shit I ever heard. I still subscribe, but thumbs down. You know what? I couldn't give any less shit if you're subscribed or not. Like, you're a dust in the universe. You're like a spectral. But I do not appreciate you being, as you say, a dumbest shit in the planet, misinforming people about something that, as you well put it, can kill you. Now, I know for North American folks, there is this concept in which something, it isn't lethal until it is. Like, for instance, a firearm, a bullet, you know, you can hold the bullet in your hand, it's not going to do shack shit, you can even load the gun, but the bullet itself only kills you if you shoot the gun, or if, you know, if you detonate the powder charge. You get the point. The bullet is harmless unless you're in this way and it's being shot. And that is the only scenario that I can think right off my ass in which something goes from absolutely not harming a human being to actually killing it. Because even drowning somebody in water kind of takes its time. You know, it's not like you chuck somebody into the river and they die, boom, immediately. But if you shoot, you know, a handgun to your head and blow your brains out, that is immediate. Now, since apparently you're such an idiot and such a douchebag that you can't use Google, and at the same time, you not only cannot use Google, but you are trying to misinform other people. And pressure in the human body, affecting the human body, it is a real condition. And you should, you know, educate yourself more than filming some nunchuck cowboy kind of scenario that, you know, like, seriously, US people and, you know, first world country people can be annoyingly stupid without their knowledge. You know what they say about stupidity? That the last person that actually realize it's the worst evil of all, because the last person realizing it's a stupid is the person that is a stupid, because it's so stupid that it's not realizing it is. Now, of course, I'm not going to get into a plane after diving. That will be something out of my budget altogether, but still people should be aware that barometric pressure can not only instantly kill you, can make you feel like shit. Now, I'm going to address my specific case that I was talking about after I actually explain, you know, the most common cases. But still, you're a dick. You shouldn't be trying to, quote, educate other people, because you are an idiot. And idiots should not be educating anyone or anything. You shouldn't be able to train a dog, for what I know of you. So, you know what? I'm not monetized. I don't give a shit about money. I'm just doing my channel to inform people. And, you know, if you treat people like shit, especially the ones who doesn't give a shack shit about your fucking comment, you're going to get banned. You are going to get trapped in a limbo where you're going to get not only burned, but shamed by me. Because, you know, I kind of know a thing or two apparently that you don't. Now please open Google and right off the start, whenever you start reading, you know, whatever you're looking for, you're going to see you're not the only one trying to check for this. That's because, you know, how does barometric pressure affect humans? Biometric pressures, headaches, nausea, falling and easy or sick, shortness of breath, tiredness or fatigue. Why do I feel sick when the barometric pressure changes? When the outside barometric pressure lowers, it creates a difference between the pressure in the outside air and the air that is inside your sinuses. That can result in pain. The same happens when you're on a plane. Can barometric pressure affect the human body? When barometric pressure is high, the pressure pushes muscles against your body and limits how much a tissue can expand. On the other hand, when the atmosphere pressure is low, it allows all your body tissues to expand, putting more pressure on nerves and other parts of your body. Now, as you can see, I'm not making this up. These are things corroborated by science. Low barometric pressure fatigue, it is a thing. Low barometric pressure fatigue can also cause, you know, fatigue. This happens for several reasons. First, low barometric pressure is synonymous with low light levels. These are low levels of natural light and cause your body to produce more melatonin. So if you weren't aware what melatonin is, you do not deserve to be subscribed to my channel. Because we're literally selling that shit on tablets for people to sleep. Now, going on. Sensing weather change. If you are like me, you might find it most difficult to breathe when there are changes in the air of barometric pressure. The shortness of breath is called dyspnea. I don't really know if I'm pronouncing that right. The air pressure in your lungs has to be less than the air outside your lungs to get your lungs inflated, you know, like normal science. So let's just educate Lil Billy because, you know, he kind of needs that in his life, apparently. You know, I get along with rednecks and idiots as long as they're not spreading shit around. Now, of course, barometric pressure can affect the human body. It depends on the individual, it depends on who is experimenting the symptoms, how their bodies are in such state and moment, how, you know, drastic is the barometric pressure changed, and all of these are scientific facts that you can check if you Google them. I'm not asking you to even lift your ass and go to a library. Google them, because if you have a YouTube channel and you have, you know, a phone or access to the internet, I'm pretty sure you can Google that. So what happens here, as I was saying up, is that barometric pressure changes a lot when a very big storm is coming. Of course, you might be thinking about the guy who dived in deep waters and, you know, a few hours later got on a plane, the plane got, you know, too high, like cruiser altitude, and the guy died. This is something that can happen, has happened. There's even an episode of Dr. House about that, I think. So people going diving and then getting into planes are just as stupid as you are when it comes to understand what the fuck is going on with barometric pressure and humans. The thing is, we are not prepared. Some people, you know, have you ever gone outdoor whenever you're climbing, you know, like a high mountain, like, and you feel dizzy and they call it altitude sickness? That is a change on the barometric pressure of your body. And people die from that, okay? But you don't need to necessarily die to know and experience some of the, you know, popular side effects of it. What happens is, first of all, as I was saying, I'm very susceptible to these changes. As much as I can smell a fart 2 miles away. Because apparently God just made everything inside my body being extra perceptive. Everything that happens, I perceive them. And that is, you know, a burden. more than, it's not a superpower. If you're ever, you know, given that, just don't accept it. It's a piece of shit to live with that. Whenever somebody farts in my house, 2 seconds after the fart went out their asses, I can no being in another room with the door closed and sealed, which is, you know, very annoying. And what happens every year, and I have like 40 of these storms, because it happens once a year, is the change of the barometric pressure. It makes me feel very sick. Now, we can add this up to the fact that I have less blood inside me, because I'm currently on my menstrual cycle that just happened to collide with, you know, this storm that we are experiencing. So I'm getting, you know, it's easy to breathe right now. And this guy is telling me that's not true, you know? Like, oh no, that's you're an idiot. This is bullshit. You know what? Stick that dick off your head. Seriously. Seriously. You don't give me advices on how my body works and how, you know, the entire medical community of planet Earth think this is a thing. So you're an idiot and you deserve a video just for people to know your face and know that you're an idiot. Because that is how we cure idiots, by exposing them, by making other people know that whatever comes from this guy's ass is just shit. All right? So he doesn't poop knowledge. He poops shit all over the place and make a mess. And then he make it sounds like you should be grateful that he's still there. You know what? You're blocked, dude. I'm not valuing myself through subscribers or followers. I don't give a crap about that. So you can, you know, unsubscribe if you can ever find my channel, because pretty sure you're going to come back with an alternative account, which are fairly easy to open, that I haven't blocked yet, just to keep watching my videos, because you're that much of an idiot, an asshole, and I was going to name an animal, but seriously, animals just don't deserve to be compared to you. Animals at the least learn about what they're into to survive. So for starters, you might not know, just like, you know, many men just don't know how the menstrual cycle of the woman's work, that, you know, they kind of know, but they don't know. You are not going to comprehend what I'm about to say, but I'm going to say it anyway. You know, just so it's on record. Whenever you have very strong menstrual cycles, you lose a lot of blood. This is the case with my mom, and it is the case with me. Of course, my mom is not on her period since for, you know, years now. She's 70-something. So 70 is just not an age in which you want your blood to leave your body. But still, it is something genetically kind of inherits, because apparently, you know, it's like cancer. It's no definitive theory that it can be inherited, but if you look at a family tree and many people on that family tree had the same type of cancer or have a proclivency to get cancer, it's more likely that their descendants, no matter how, they're going to get cancer at some point. And I know this because some branches of my own family have this. You know, like, you can see grand-grand-grandpa had cancer, and then one of the kids had cancer, and then one of the other kids had cancer. And every generation, there's at very least 2 to 3 people, no matter what age, no matter where they are, that exhibit symptoms of cancer. And they get treated for cancer, and some recover, some just die, you know, bad luck. But it is something kind of genetic, and it seems like, you know, how much the menstrual cycle hits you might be kind of like that. Not every single woman gets hit the same way. Now, I'm going to include just, you know, a couple clips on the end of this video just for you, so you can kind of understand. Like, I've seen guys like you that still think that we, women, are lying when we say we have 3 holes in our body. one for pooping, another one for bleeding, and another one for peeing. And you guys go, no, but I just have my dick and my ass. So you guys might have two. No, we don't have two holes like you, busters. We need three holes. And the reason of that is because we are going to birth the baby, not you. You can use your dick to ejaculate or pee, depending on your day. But we cannot pee over the baby. So, since we cannot do that, our biology is wired completely different. And I thank any cosmic unity right there that we are. Because I wouldn't be one to be lumped together with people like you. You are the reason why I want humanity to die, for instance. And not because of me. I don't take this personal. What I take personal is the lack of common knowledge that is available at your fingertips, dude. So, this is a huge storm. I'm about to, you know, I am right now, but I was about to get indisposed. I was about to get my period, and my blood pressure was already low. Generally, it is low when I'm about to go through my period. But that combined with the storm, it makes it unbearable. Like a buzzing sound inside my ears, dizziness, nausea. And don't worry, I've gone to the doctor 1,000 times since I leave, because like I said, I went through 40 of these storms and I've been having my period since I was 11 years old. So 30 years, I found myself having this problem. And you're not going to come here and said that everybody on Google, every single doctor that studied for years, and every single person like me that experienced this for years is wrong and you're right. Because that is coming straight out of your ass. You're seriously... Sorry, I have trouble breathing, you know? The thing is, yeah, sure. It can kill you. Now, this barometric pressure, it won't kill me. I know because, you know, 30 years into that, you cannot realize when somebody is about to kill you or not. It won't kill me, but does not mean that it won't give me symptoms. All right? Symptoms. I'm not saying it's going to kill me. I'm saying many people, not just me, many people suffer from these symptoms. It is a combination of factors that ended up with you having, for instance, in my case, less blood than the one I should have during those days. Because blood is being used to clean my uterus. So for some reason, my body decides next month, oh, haven't you, you know, changed your mind about having a kid? Do you want to get pregnant? And I'm again going to say, no, fuck you, I'm waiting for the menopause. But all in all, whatever my body decides to go and make me go through this shit every single fucking month, you need to acknowledge that a woman has 1 week prior getting her period preparing for it. It starts to hurt, you start to feel bad, you know, you're fighting for staying alive, basically. Then you have your period, worst week of the month, you know, 7 days in hell each fucking month. For the rest of your life until you, you know, you lost your period if you're lucky. I've seen people having their periods up to 80. I hope I'm not into those people. I really hope I don't get my period the next month, if possible. And I know menopausic people around there say, no, but you get the heat. And trust me, if I'm going to choose one, I'd rather have the heat than this. Because I already have... you know, stomach issues. I already have irritable bowel syndrome. I already have, you know, a lot of issues with my stomach. So I rather have issues in some other organ of my body, like my skin. So that's that. And the week after we get our period, it takes us around a week to get back to normal. If you have done the math, which I doubt, but, you know, simple math, every month have 4 weeks. That means usually women like me, who are, you know, the majority of us, are absolutely fighting for our lives for 3 weeks out of four, and only 1 week in the entire month, we can do things. And this is annoying because, you know, sometimes I need to put together a furniture. You know, I go to whatever you call a Home Depot. Here we call it Easy. It's the brand we use. Or a Target. I don't know. We go to Walmart, whatever it is. We purchase this, you know, assemble yourself kind of furniture, you know, like things that you're going to put in your walls. I don't know. It could be libraries or any other sort of furniture in your house you're gonna put together. Of course, you can pay some dude that doesn't know shuck shit what he's doing, or you can do it yourself. I do it myself because I know what I'm doing. So it's not about the money. Seriously, it's just cheap. If you don't want to go through the hassle, you can just pay for a coin. They can come to your house. But I don't want to expose myself to some dude that I don't know if it has COVID or what the fuck. And I don't know if it's going to steal me or whatever is going to happen. You know, all in all, very limited space to work on inside my room. So if the if this furniture is going to go inside my room, I need to, you know, do it myself. Because you can't feed more than one person at a time here. And whenever something like that happens, or I have to clean a fish tank, for instance, or I have to move a heavy set of rocks, or I have to be standing next to some fire, just hitting a knife to make holes into a Tupperware to transform it into a place where a leopard gecko can, you know, live. Whatever I'm going to do, I need to just time it right, which means that my life is a quick time event video game every single time for the rest of my life, and has been like that since I can remember, mostly. So my life is like a quick time event. I need to, if I have to do something, like for instance, whenever I'm starting to feel, and this is something you're not going to understand, first of all, because you're an idiot. Second, because, you know, you're not a woman. Whenever you feel like, because it doesn't matter, I'm pretty much regular on my schedule, on my month, but sometimes I'm not. So what happens is that when I feel like, you know, I kind of feel like in 3 days I might be bleeding. So you kind of sense that because you know your body, your own body, and you can sense that, you know, despite you thinking I don't. So when I sense that kind of shit, I kind of go, okay, I need to just take the worms, the mealworms, the superworms. I need to check every single, up to the last moment, every single little bit of place, you know, of thing that I have to do, and just do it before I start bleeding. Because when I start bleeding, I might not attend to my animals for a couple days because I can't get out from bed, because I literally pass out if I do so. Therefore, you know, I'm losing blood continuously. There is a big storm front, and I already show you evidence of what the doctors, not me, the doctors, said about that. There is a change, a very drastic change of pressure on the air surrounding me. I'm having difficulty breathing. Really, right now, I'm having a very hearty time because, you know, and all of this gets combined. And sure, it ain't gonna kill me. Sure, ain't gonna kill me, because I'm not a fucking idiot that went diving and then hop into a plane right after. Ain't gonna kill me, but trust me when I say I'm not in my best shape, and this affects my body. So, since I'm playing shenmue with my, you know, I need to do this and that, and I need to get the timing right, because whenever I start bleeding, I need to stop whatever the fuck I'm doing, because I'm going to pass on the floor if I try to, you know, forget about the pain. The pain, the cramps are unbearable. And there is absolutely no medication, unless you get really high, that is going to make you forget how much pain you're into. So, again, forget the pain, you know. My pain threshold, apparently based on my experience with other people, it's kind of a little bit higher up on the high side, you know, perhaps because I've been feeling pain all the time and it's not something that I enjoy, but it's something your body gets used to it. So it's not less valid. You're still in so fucking pain. But at the same time, you kind of handle it better. I bet if I were to your house, little Billy, and just, you know, smack one of your testicles against a door, you won't be able to breathe. Now, that is the amount of pain I feel every single month, and I do not complain about it. I do not. You know, weird, right? Weird that you're such a crybaby, and I'm not. And you have the testicles, but not the will to use them. I don't have the testicles, but I'm, you know, pretty much braver than you, dickhead. Yes, I'm rossing you, because I am on my menstrual cycle, which means I'm more aggressive than usually. And you picked the wrong time of the month to fuck with me. And you picked the wrong topic to fuck about. And you picked everything wrong to do around that. Like, assuming that your presence is valuable to me. Nobody's presence is valuable to me. Something I learned around the years is that friends, just as much as subscribers, are like, you know, little diners on the side of the road that you go and people get in and out constantly. People get into your life and then at some point they get out and that's normal. So you're not unique, snowflake dude. I'm sorry, Billy. I'm sorry, little Billy. You're not, you know, irreplaceable. I don't give a shit about you. But I am very upset that you decided to use one of my videos, since you have like 7 subscribers and I have like 400, which isn't a lot, but still more than you for certain. You know, I might be bad at math, but 400 is something, it's more than 7. So, to try to quote very, very hard quotes, educate people. Educate yourself, Billy. Educate yourself before you educate people. If you are listening to this and you happen to be, because I know, you know, not that anyone lives in Argentina for that matter, but you get yourself trapped in some area which is about to hit a monsoon and, you know, a very huge storm front is going to hit you, you might feel these symptoms. You might feel bad, like you can't breathe. It ain't going to kill you. In most cases, it's just not going to. You know, if not, people will be dying left and right. It's not going to kill you, but still it's going to be extremely uncomfortable. And you're going to know when the storm is going to hit. If you listen to your body, you're literally going to have the tools to kind of predict what the fuck's going on. Because nothing perceives our environment like our bodies. I know. It's a stupid that I have to remind you guys this. Because, you know, if you're using YouTube and you're using your eyes and you're using your ears and you're using your fingers to perceive the world around you in a physical way, it also means that you already know that you perceive the world through your body. And your body is just not limited to your 5 senses. I think there is a 6th one people is still debating about. It's not seeing ghosts, you know, it's not that. It's just a 6th kind of sense, I don't know for what. But if you are sensitive enough, you're going to get very ill, very sick. You're going to feel tired, and it's not depression, it's just tiredness, nausea, dizziness. You know, some people even experience the need to kind of vomit, even though they kind of never do it, but they kind of feel like it. It's a horrible time for some people. They are all bitty. I don't know how you get called, but you're uploading videos of I don't know what the fuck, a Chinese dude in a cowboy costume using nunchakus, which I'm guessing it's one of your friends that you convinced to make a very racist stereotype and just, you know, kind of mock your friend in the process, even if your friend thinks you're not. So, fuck you, Billy. Fuck you. That's not cool. You know, you can't shit on anybody else. Just don't shit on your friends. I never did that. And my morals? Questionable. As you have no idea. Very questionable morals I have. But still, don't do that. It's not making you good any better. So, like I was saying, yes, this is a thing that science has recorded. Not only, even if you weren't going to have your period during this time, you know, with the period, it hits you way harder, way, because your body, it's absolutely ultra sensitive. Your body is, you know, looking for excuses to shit on you. Like right now, I feel the entire room is spinning. And the only thing I have took was 2 ibuprofen for the pain that don't do shuck shit. So trust me, Billy, it gets worse when you're a woman and you're near your period or going through your period at all. Gets worse. But if you're not, even if you are, you know, a normal woman that just happens not to be on her period or a week after or a week prior, you're just on that golden week in which you can actually do shit without having to worry if you're going to end them or not, or if you're going to just pass away in the process. Even if you're in your best timing of the month, you're still going to feel that. Now, you might not be that perceptible to, you know, barometric changes on the environment, but that is something that you specifically are, you know, experiencing. You cannot spread that notion up to certain people. I have no way to know if you certainly never experienced this because perhaps, you know, there is a reason why DNA is different from one person to the other, and that is that even though we're all human beings, we are not biologically the same. We're different. So it might hit some people more than it hits other. In my case, it kind of really hits hard. And if I'm around my period, it hits even harder. So I know this is going to sound extra cliche, but I have lived my life with, you know, mostly male friends around. And trust me, I've seen too many guys, and not like in I'm fuck them, some, but not all, like being my friends, and some of them were so stupid, naive, and misinformed about certain things that should be common knowledge since the second year of your high school, which is, you know, human anatomy, which I'm going to try to pretend. I hope you went to high school. I hope that you pay attention, even if you were, because just going to high school and not giving a shit about paying attention, it's just the same as not going. So I'm going to try to think that you went to the high school and you pay attention to the teacher and you actually took some interest into comprehending what the fuck's going on with the human body. But given the fact that you cannot and will not use Google prior burning yourself and setting yourself like Bonzo on fire in front of everybody else, like, I'm going to guess you either didn't went to school, or if you went, you weren't paying shuck shit attention to what they were saying. So let's just work with that. You are just, you know, fresh out of the moon, apparently. And I say the moon because there are no schools or books there. So, seriously, barometric pressure can affect you even if you haven't been climbing a mountain, even if you haven't been, you know, swimming the depths of the sea. It can still affect you. It will affect you. This is a fact. This is a scientific fact. Do not believe what asshole Billy Lil Billy does says, because he knows shuck shit. And I'm not asking you listeners to trust me. I'm asking you listeners to open your Chrome, your Mozilla Firefox. I was about to say Internet Explorer, but there is no more. So open whatever browser you have, your Opera, whatever it is, your Chrome, just open it up and Google effects of low barometric pressure on human body. You're going to scroll, not the first three results, just all of them. Just compare them. Do what smart people do, which is not clicking on the first link. Go all the way down, like, you know, at very least 12 to 20 results in your Google's result. So you kind of get different opinions from different years, from different portals of medicine, from different doctors. And you're going to see everybody agrees. People who have studied way more than me, because I never studied to be a doctor. I kind of became one, but I'm like Rambo style doctor, you know, like I'm crisis situation doctor. But if you put me to do, I don't know, brain surgery, I will know jack shit about what I'm doing. It's still, you know, a mystery for neurosurgeons most of the times. Imagine me. So the closer to a brain I've been is being in a supermarket and watching some cow's brain on a platter, because something we eat, yeah, disgusting, I know. But it is some part, we eat every single part of the cow, everyone. That includes bones sometimes. So the thing is, you need to stop giving advices if you don't know what the fuck you're talking about. I know what I'm talking about because I do not only do my research, but I experience it. Now, I'm going to be honest with you, listeners. Of course, there's a lot of room for me to make mistakes, because as much as I wouldn't want to be human, I am. So being human, it means that you can be wrong. Now, when somebody calls me out and says, you know, this is not how you said it was, and you know, it gives me a solid reason besides the cat, you know, then I tend to listen to them and, you know, re-research and try to inform myself. And obviously, if I screw it up, I will include it in another video, you know, later on, whenever I do the next video. Also, I'm going to say, look, you remember what I said? I was wrong about that, you know? I was wrong. Somebody called me out. Somebody just gave me new info. I researched it. But you know what happened with you, Lil Billy? Was that you gave me some shit info, and I was already sure it was shit. But still, I gave you the, you know, I give you the opportunity to be right. So I turned back to Google, and I just said, okay, let's just Google this up. Perhaps I am wrong, and I'm feeling like shit for 30 years. For some other reason, which is unfathomable, but okay. And when I go, there are, you know, thousands of doctors saying the exact same thing I said. So then again, I get absolutely shuck shit, flustered about the fact that I cannot believe that you are trying to educate me, bastard. So the best you can do right now is to hide yourself under some rock and just, you know, pray for people who do not recognize your face at all, because you're an idiot. You are, and you'll always be. And for what I've seen of the contents of your videos, you're not just an idiot. You're a racist and an, you know, overall an awful person. So, sincerely, you not subscribe to this channel, it's a huge favor you are making me. The universe is making me that favor. Because I don't want people like you, not even 6 oceanic miles apart from me. I don't want that kind of people. Now, like I've been said, there has been times since I'm human being that I'm wrong. And I like to be proven wrong because that gives me the drive to go ahead and research something that I thought I had clear on my head. But all of a sudden, I realized, hey, you know what? There has been some new developments in the last years. There have been, you know, new discoveries, new people saying new shit, and I need to get up to speed. That is how I learn. So I can be wrong, but in this particular case, nah. Because, like I said, nah. So without trying to repeat myself over and over again, especially if you're a woman, you will experience this more than a man, because apparently men can stumble upon, you know, American continent and not realizing it's not the Indian continent. So let's just assume that you are more perceptive to these kind of things. If you live, for instance, not in a city, I happen to be born and live my entire life in the city, which is, you know, the equivalent to living in New York. It's a very crowded city, very cosmopolitan city, you know, lots of car, lots of light, lots of city, real city, you know, not in the field. But I have family in the fields, you know. You know, I went there when I was younger, and I went there to visit them. And especially the women of the family, if they have been living a long time in the fields, they tend to realize that something it's going to, and it's not, you know, the clouds on the sky or whatever shit you're thinking, or the movement of the birds, or no. Even without any of that, they might be sitting on their bed, eyes closed, and know that a storm is coming based on how they feel. So we are part of this planet. We are made of the same molecules that the rest of the universe is made. And sometimes we can detect, even without lifting a finger, that a very huge storm is coming based on how shit we feel. For no reason. So, if you're one of those people, like I said in some anecdote about me being a dick as a kid, I was so good at predicting very fairly big storms coming that I remember clearly that day that my mom got me a plastic green flute. I didn't know how to play the instrument, the real one. And even if I knew, you know, this was like a make-believe. It made sounds, but I'm guessing nobody can play anything in that. Not properly, at least. So I took this green flute to the kindergarten. And during, you know, recess, there's all these kids running around the patio and they're all wanting to take shit out of me because that is how it works. You know, nobody asks for permission when there are five. There are just idiots running around and taking your shit without knowing the consequences. So at some point, I just remove myself as far as I could from the main group. I sit myself on the ground and I already knew a storm was coming. I could feel it. I knew. I was a year more than them, so I had to be six when they were five or so. So I had what was like, or seven perhaps I was, you know, not much of a difference. I knew the storm was coming. Sit myself, take my flute, and start trying to make noises with it because it was my toy, goddammit. So, you know, the other kids come just rushing out because, you know, kids are like animals. They hear a noise, they go straight through it. So they come here, try to take my flute away. And I say, No, you're not taking this from me. And of course, kids being kids, that is why I don't have kids, if you're asking. You know, kids are unbearable. They say, oh, but what are you going to do? You can't use a kibble. And I said, I'm going to make rain, you know, like an Indian. Like, you know, a kind of, they should be grateful that I didn't say I'm going to sacrifice one of you to make the ritual complete. And of course, my body already knew a storm front was coming. And when you live in the city, what happens is that you don't see the horizon. There's barely any birds to give you an idea that a storm is coming or not. But you feel it. Every single storm cloud, it's often hidden behind very tall buildings. So you cannot see the storm coming. You kind of know the storm is coming based on how you feel, but you don't know that. And you know why? Because the pressure in the air changes and you feel the storm approaching. So you can tell if you listen to your body and how bad or better it feels, you can tell how close the storm is coming. You know, like what is the intensity of the storm and when it is going to hit. And I just feel like it's going to rain down power in, you know, the next couple minutes. I can't feel this bad and there not be a storm. So what I told them was I'm going to use this floor to, you know, generate storm. So the kids just laugh at me like kids do. I stay with my usual shit face there, like poker face, and I play the flute. So I kind of did that. And about a minute and a half after I stopped playing, downpour, heavy rain, whatever you want to call it. The sky opens, all down. So the kids start screaming and running and going around calling out for the teacher because she's a witch. She made rain fall. And I didn't make shack shit. I didn't make rain fall from the sky. The rain was there. The only thing I did was to, you know, accurately predict that if I was feeling that bad, there was a big storm about to hit. But the kids, being naive bastards like you, little belly, you know, being idiots like you, little belly, they run to the teacher. They hide from me. They were terrified because in that moment, they all thought I made the rain. Not that I predicted something based on how my body felt. So I'm there and I just pull up my little plastic, it had some dinosaurs on it, umbrella, and I just stay there like, fuck you all. And the teacher, it's, you know, her hands are on the hips and she's looking at me, absolutely distressed about the panic that I have just caused. And she's like, you know, she calls me by my surname, which I'm not going to say out loud, but she is like, you, what you did this time? And I'm like, I didn't do anything. What you did this time? We're going to call your parents. Call them. I will be very fun if you try to explain that I made rain. No, you did not make rain appear, but you scare all these kids. And I mind you not, I was the same age and I was talking to the teacher like if I was the teacher's age. Yeah, I was that creepy kid. You know, a very, very smart and adult person for the body I was given. Like nobody properly resent me when I just, you know, died the last time and somehow I have knowledge I shouldn't have, or something elder is attached to me giving some knowledge that I shouldn't have by that time in my life. Because, you know, and I'm there. And of course I got taken because I was still my age, legally. I got taken to the principal's office and they called my dad and my mom, and my dad just don't give a shit. He stayed sleeping, so my mom showed up and she said, what do you do now? And I said, nothing, ma. You know, it's not my fault that these kids just get scared so easily. Ain't my fault. So, you know, I just play with my toy, which you gave me, and they tried to take it off me. And I said, I'm going to make rain go down because I knew a storm was coming and they freaked out. And by now, the crisis, you know, in kindergarten hall was huge. Like 20 little kids screaming their shit lungs out of their chest, terrified of me. And I was just like, please let this stick. Because if you let them remember that I'm somebody, for whatever wrong reason, but that I'm somebody they don't want to mess with, they're going to leave me alone. They're going to give me the fuck alone. So I'm praying this is going to happen. This is going to work. This is how it's going to happen. Obviously, by first grade, they lost that and I needed to build again fear on them. So they will leave me alone because I wasn't like a bully just to be a bully. I bullied people when people was kicking me on the floor. And at some point I just had enough shit and I just lift myself up and start pushing people out the stairs. Yeah, I was a kind of an evil kid if you think about it. But in my defense, I'll say if they wouldn't have beat the shit out of me, they wouldn't have bled so badly whenever I broke their noses. So again, it was nothing planned. I never planned, you know, like today I'm going to break a nose. No, it was like back in the day, I know you kids might not know about this, but we had this huge metallic, it was like a lunchbox, like an old metallic lunchbox, but there wasn't food inside. There was just, you know, pencils, pens, erasers, whatever you needed, it was there. And here we call them cartucheras. But I don't know how they're like pencil holders or something. I don't know what you guys call them. And what happened was that I loved this because it was heavy and it fit my pack so well. And, you know, I had, like, I loved drawing, making drawings, little noodles and around that and practicing. I wasn't much into, you know, paying attention to either the class or my fucking classmates. So I just, you know, finished the exercise in the first 5 to 10 minutes of the class, or declare this is something I'm not going to be able to, even if I try, so I will be better prepared next time. I'm just going to leave the sheet blank. And of course, whenever somebody attacked me, they already knew I have like a very, very full of books and metallic containers backpack. And if they fucked me enough, they were going to get my backpack on their faces, arms, chest, whatever it is, with my strength. And I kid you not, I was the tallest and biggest kid on the entire year. And possibly on the next year, they were just small kids. So more than once, I made them bleed. It wasn't intentional, but it happened. You know, they had it coming. They fucked me up for too long. And I had, every time somebody will fuck me up, I will just warn them 3 times. If by the 3rd time they were still throwing sticks at me from, you know, some chair in the back, if they were still, you know, chewing my eraser because they felt like it, and I hadn't figured out that my eraser wasn't when, you know, in my table, whenever they did something they shouldn't have done, they got the backpack on their faces, on their noses. I need to be honest on that. Once, it was my elbow. It wasn't my backpack. So, yeah, I broke a nose with an elbow. But in my defense, again, I would say the kid just wouldn't let me go. The kid wanted to play, you know, hide and seek. I don't know what it was. He wanted to play. And we were all waiting for our moms to just take us back home. So what happens is this kid, you know, when my mom just says, yeah, you know, they say my surname, it's a school. Your mom's here. And I'm like, okay, I pick up my backpack and I'm just, you know, putting my backpack. And this stupid kid jumps and tries to grab my back, saying, no, stay and play, when I never play anything with anybody. So now let's just play. And I, with all the strength and might of my frame, which was a lot, like twice bigger as the kid, even if we were in the same, you know, in the same year, I was twice as big as him. I just, you know, I'm trying to put my backpack. Imagine the motion you're doing with your arms. You're stretching them backwards. You're not watching backwards because, you know, all of a sudden, all your strength goes to your arm to pull back and just grab the backpack and put it on the right place. So I'm doing this motion and the kid's face is in between my elbow and my backpack. And the mom of that kid chases for 2 blocks with the kid just pouring blood. So at that point, I didn't understand kids. I didn't understand moms for that matter. Because if your kid is just with a broken nose, don't chase whoever kid did that involuntarily. Don't chase them for 2 blocks. Your priority should be taking your kid to a hospital, not chasing some other mom with some other kid, especially if you know that tomorrow I'm going to be there. It's not like I'm a wanted fugitive. I'm not a fly risk. I'm not going to just change school because I did that. So you can't just give us shit the next day. You don't have to give us shit now. Right now, what you should be doing is taking your kids to a doctor, not chasing me. But she did. She did. Blood all over from the school up to 2 blocks, straight out to my house. And, you know, the kid there bleeding, unable to talk, of course. And my mom just said, "You did that." And I was like, "I think I hit something when I put my backpack." And like, I think I did. I was like, I have nothing against that kid right now, but kind of did. So you kind of understand the situation. The mom of the kid was furious. You know? Although it was a shitty mom, it should be in the hospital, not chasing me. But still, furious. And I kind of like, sorry, dude, but you, when I say I'm not playing anymore, I'm going to my home, you should not try to retain me because you know I'm bigger than you, like twice as big as you, twice as thick and twice as tall as you. That means that my body, even if I'm not trying to hurt you, might hurt you. It's like, you know, the train doesn't want to hurt you, but if you stay on the tracks and just wait for the train to pass, the train ain't gonna say something like, "Oh, you know what? I'm stopping right here, right now. I'm not gonna talk." No, the train's gonna run you over. So that was kind of the situation here. And, you know, there were times, and I'm responsible for that, there were times I pushed people off the stairs because they were laughing at me. And I asked them 3 times to stop, and they didn't, because kids don't fucking listen until you push them from the ladder. And every time I did something like that, it will keep them at bay for at least a couple months until somebody else finds some other new shit to say about me. So it was like an defense mechanism. I never went bullying people that didn't deserve it. Like Tony Montana said, I never fucked up anybody in my life that didn't have it coming. And that applies to you, Lil Billy. You know, when I fucked somebody, it had it coming. That is my MO. That is how I work. If you had it coming and you do some shit around me, there's a, you know, 70% chances that I'm not going to ignore it. Of course, there's a 30% chances I'm going to ignore it if it's not, you know, it's not important enough or I'm doing something else. I mean, it's just, you know, it's just a stupid people on the stupid internet. I grew up with a cassette tape player, so get the point. I don't need the internet. The internet needs me more than I need the internet. Because apparently people on the internet, it's getting progressively more stupid by the second. So, all in all, I'll just say, yes, when a storm is coming, the barometric pressure of the air, it's going to make you feel in your body symptoms. And it doesn't mean that it's an instant death. You're not going to die from it. But I assure you, you're going to feel it. Regardless of what my little subscriber Billy is saying right there. It's not a stupid shit. It's a scientific fact. And being a book eater like I am, and I always been, looking people say stupid shit, like, you know, filling a bathtub with dry ice and then going under the fumes and then getting surprised when they just die. It's something that I can't wrap my head around it, and that people should be informed very well about this. Because if you're not, I mean, like, you have the right not to be informed about this phenomenon, because nobody is into everything. Like, I'm kind of into everything, but nobody, like, I know very few people like me, if any. So there is not an obligation for you to know how this works. But if you need to know, you don't want to take advice from an idiot. Because if you take advice from an idiot, you're not going to be safe. You're not going to be all right. So, pressure in the air changes and it makes you feel like shit. You know, deep sea divers, this is another important information you might want to keep in your head. Whenever you go, I think it's like 10 meters or I never went diving. You know, I'm an excellent swimmer, even though I almost never am into the water. I don't know why it comes so natural for me to dive, but I am. But I never went into actual diving. So the more I could go down was 3 meters, 4 meters. It was like the deepest part of any pool I ever been. Still, when you go 10 meters or more, the pressure in the air that is inside your body, your lungs, the air you're breathing, and the pressure, you know, from the sea, it is different. So you can go from making your brain a scrambled egg to actually kind of imploding. We had a submarine, which was Ara San Juan. You can Google that up. Argentina, Ara San Juan. And the guys just went to the bottom because they lost control of the submarine and the pressure of the water just crushed them. This was an international news, so perhaps you haven't even heard about them. I think it was the Infinity. Yeah, it was Ocean Infinity was the Enterprise that sent this little no man's inside capsules, you know, made of steel to just register what, because we just wouldn't find the fucking thing. We knew they were dead, you know, like after 2 months, you know, these people either ran off air or run out of food, they're dead. So I'm sorry for the families, I really am, but they're dead. So at very least, we wanted to find the submarine. And, you know, Ocean Infinity, I think it was the Enterprise that finally just said, you know what, we're going to do it for free. If we find this submarine, you pay us. If we don't, it's on us. And my government was just like, you know what? Yeah, sure, we could use the help. You know, we have lost these people for too many months now. And we have like, you know, these were military people. So we had military families, you know, crying and complaining and you know, lots of shit's going on there. So the thing is that when you're a diver and you go too deep, you need, when you go, you know, cave diving, for example, you need to make stops. You know, you have a line and you make a stop. I never went diving, but I have this understood because I'm a weird nerd that I, you know, uncover things that I will never need to know, but I still want to know. So you need make stops. And the stops, you can't just go from the cave you were diving in to the surface. You need to make the stops, because if you don't, the pressure will fuck you up so hard it will kill you. So you need to stop, like, I don't know, 15 minutes, 10 minutes, just going up and then stop. You grab to the cable and wait. And what you're waiting is for your body, you know, the same body like me that predicted there was a storm coming. What you worry is that your human body normalizes the pressure. And then you go a little bit up and stop and wait again. and on and on and on until you reach the surface. And you are at sea level, which means the pressure is completely different than from the place you were a few minutes ago. So this is a thing, people. And I do not know why should I be explaining something that kills so many people and made so many other people feel like shit during so many times. Whenever you're climbing a mountain, you know, like hikers like to do that shit. You know, hikers are famous for two things. Going places where they shouldn't have gone. And, you know, having problems with the pressure of the air. The higher you go, the more pressure again. You know, like, and getting, they get sickness from that pressure, from that change. And they don't die, like our little Billy said. They don't die, but they still feel like shit. I once in my life, I shall never do that again. I was forced to, but the coordinations, you know, the guys coordinating our group at a summer camp. Yes, I was in one. Whenever you finish elementary school, there was a trip. Your parents could send you or not. You could go or not. It was up to you. But it was your first trip without your parents. The objective was to let you know that you could handle things on your own. Of course, it was like shit for me, but still. One of the activities, because every single day we had like three people, adults, you know, counselors, guiding us and, you know, preparing things and whatnot. We were, you know, dinner, breakfast, you know, all the things. We worked in this hotel, very guarded, was very responsible from them. And that's all I say. And I tried to smuggle some little tiny baby frogs and they kind of asphyxiated. And the person cleaning the room while I was out keep, you know, tossing them to the garbage. And I was like, fucking hell. You know what, how many time it took me to put those little tiny frogs into that bottle? You piece of shit. I want to take them to the city. I want them to be frogs from the city. You know, so the thing is, one of these activities, they were, you know, a week, just a week. You know, not much time, but in a week, they could show you kind of around like, this is how the world is going to look because you're entering adulthood. So some days we went to bars, which were meant to for, you know, alcoholic drinking and adults, but we went prior the actual bars or pubs getting open for those clients. And we were served, you know, sodas or, you know, some shoes or whatever. But we were starting to get accustomed to looking at the bar from the inside. You know, this was the same bar. Of course, they weren't giving us alcohol, but still, it was a new experience. And one of these amazing new experiences, or at least I think they thought it would be amazing, that they keep doing every single year and still do. They still do. I don't know why, but they still do. Was to climb a mountain. It wasn't a mountain. It was like more of a hill, a very steep hill, which was called the cross because it has like a white, huge cross in the middle. So we needed to go. And when I was like, I don't know, 50 meters on the road, I started to feel my ears buzzing and my entire body like, you know what, you're feeling tired, but it's not because you walk too much, you're just feeling weird. And you need, if you know your body, you know the difference between being infected and being half dead, in between being, you know, tired from the trip and tired because something else is going on there. So I needed to stop like three times. And it wasn't just that much of a high. But there was two other kids that passed away. One of them passed away so badly and so abruptly because kids will not tell you. They think that it's not honorable. They're, you know, little creep weirdos. They won't tell you, I'm about to pass out. please sit me somewhere. So the guy just passed out, the kid passed out, and just stumbled across the path. And behind him was another kid that broke its ankle because of that idiot that wasn't able to be polite enough to stop and say, I'm not feeling well. So eventually we reached there. It's a piece of shit. It's just a white cross. There are no bathrooms. There's nothing to buy. There are not even a souvenir saying, hey, I made it. So no, there's nothing. We stayed there like, I don't know, 10 minutes, 20 minutes. Like, it was the most slow pacing minutes of my life. And then we went back, you know. And just as much as when I was going up, when I was going back, I had the same feeling. Again, I had to stop. Like, I was just going down, stopping and saying, you know what, I need to stop. You know, like, I'm not that kind of kid that will get into an impossible dare against a Wendigo just because someone else might laugh at them at high school. I'm the kind of kid that knows that I shouldn't fuck with a Wendigo. So go ahead and do it yourself. I'm staying here. I'm that kind of kid. So atmospheric pressure affecting the human body. Even if you're not doing anything, just be not at your house. It's a thing. Do not think otherwise. It's not something you want to mess with, because it can make your ear bleed. It can make you passed out in the best case scenario, so you won't just keep trying to go up or down. It can cause you real harm, and that harm can be from a very slight inconvenience, like feeling dizzy, like feeling a little off, like realizing that a storm is coming, up to death, literally death. So it's not like little Billy said there. It's not like, yeah, you're fine, or you just drop dead. No, it's not like that. It's not that simple. Imagine you got an infection, you had a wound in your hand or whatever it is, and you go like, eh, no big deal. You know what? No big deal. And then you just, you know, weeks pass and it gets more and more infected and you're not doing shack shit about it. And of course, eventually you'll go septic and die. But it's not like one day you wake up septic out of nowhere. You had an infected wound in your body for a month. This is the same. Whenever you hear your body, and I don't mean like literally hearing it, but feeling it, you realize when you need to stop. You know, sometimes my mom just looks at me and says, you ain't gonna be able to lift that up. And I'm just moving the furniture. You ain't gonna be able to do that. And I look at my mom and said, let me, you know, assess the situation myself. Because by touching the furniture and calculating the weight or the angle or whatever it is, the task that I'm into, I know if right there I can do that or not. And I don't do this lightly. There is a reason why I'm still alive in my 40s and possibly little Billy won't be alive much longer. And that is because I hear to my body. When my body says, no, you can't move this. I don't care how much strain you're putting into that. It's not a good idea. Don't do it. Even if you kind of can, you shouldn't. And that is it. Even if you perhaps can try to, you shouldn't. And that knowledge comes from knowing your own body, from listening to your inner guts, to your, you know, your perception, not of the ghosts and the spiritual planes, but actual real world. Let's just for a second go there where you don't believe about ghosts or paranormal things, and you do not believe that these things eventually, I do believe that eventually will be explained in a scientific way, if humankind lives that long, that is. But there's a part of your body that even if you do not know scientifically, if you can move that weight, if you can balance that thing, There is something called laws of physics. There is something called your body telling you this ain't gonna work, or telling you, you know what, go for it. I bet you can. So I'm guessing little Billy just, it's Robocop, or doesn't have a body, or is just too stubborn and too stupid to hear his own body telling him when it should stop or not. I have a friend that practiced martial arts. I'm gonna name him. The guy was really cool, still is. I was actually living in the US. If you're listening to this, Tibo, yeah. So the guy practiced, you know, sports. And he was always like, you should come with me and learn Taekwondo. You know, some martial art. And I was like, I'm not going to learn Taekwondo. I'm like, why? Why wouldn't you? It's like, because half of your feet, half of your, or your little toes on your feet, dude, they're either broken or you can't feel them. That ain't good. I don't care how spectacularly you can air flip and kick somebody in the face. I'm not losing sensibility on my limbs and my appendages to try a sport. It's just not who I am. I hate sports in general, but sports that are already promising me a permanent damage on my appendages, I'm not into that. You know, I'll pass. So the guy keep, you know, every time, I remember, I don't know, he does, but I do remember one time I just step on his shoe. And I'm a heavy person. I always would, because I'm like 170 meters tall. Translate that to feet if you want, but I won't. So I was always very big. And I don't mean just, you know, chubby. I was tall. So since I was so tall, you kind of couldn't tell if I was chubby because my fat will distribute equally whenever it wanted to. I'm not like that's morbidly obese people. Like, you know, I have presence. Let's just call it like that. I could be a bouncer on a club if I wanted to. Now, the thing is that I step on him and he didn't even realize. And I instinctively turn around and apologize myself. Saying, oh, dude, I didn't saw you. Sorry. I was like, sorry for what? I was like, I just step on your feet. Oh, no, but I have no sensitivity on my fingers. And I was like, why? Oh, no, because I broke them so many times practicing Taekwondo. So I don't feel them anymore. Like, they're there. I know they're there, like they're not rotting or anything, but I kind of don't feel them. I'm like, oh my God, you're doing that to yourself? Is there any good reason? Are you planning to fight vampires or something? I know, I just love the sport. It's not a sport. It looks more like a torture. Just, you want to defend yourself? Get a fucking gun. Just don't break every single bone in your body. That's bad. You shouldn't do that. So, again, listen to your body. Because no matter how much of a douchebag, of an idiot, of a not well-informed person you are, your body comes with a set of instructions to make you feel uneasy or bad or whatever it is, whenever it is. So listen to your body. And when you start, not literally, don't use your ears. I mean, like, perceive what you're feeling through your body. And when you reach that, you will have better chances of survival in any situation. Better chances to do things easier on yourself. You know? For the same reason that I'm recording this while sitting on my bed. Because if I passed out right now, I'm not going to hit my face against anything anymore. And I do say anymore because it happened a couple of times that I just lost consciousness because I wasn't hearing my body well enough. And I said, you know, I'm dizzy. Pressure is low. Storm is hitting right now. I'm about to pass out, but I bet not if I die. And I, the next thing I knew, waking up on the floor, taking my hands to my face and saying, God damn it, what the fuck happened? And when I looked myself into the mirror, I was just, you know, pouring blood because, you know, that happens when you slam a doorknob or the floor with your face or furniture with your face and you are completely unconscious. So if I had listened to my body, I wouldn't have a very pretty scar under my lips. But that was something that made me remind that the best teacher for how to survive is my own body. If my body is saying, nah, 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 they ain't gonna work, you need to go with that. I don't care what shack shit doctor is telling me, if my body, and I don't mean pain, because people kind of just perhaps says, ah, no, if it pains, I won't go to the doctor. No, you know what? If it pains, your body is screaming, go to the doctor! You know, that is the way of the body screaming, you need attention, dude! So, listen to your body, and if it hurts more than a certain degree that you think it should be, go to the doctor. I don't care for what. Just go. Check in. I know it's expensive in the US. Here it's not that much. Still go to the doctor. I was diagnosed with a brain tumor back in the day because I didn't sleep for 3 days without coffee. So I knew by the fourth day something was going on. And I said, I don't feel any critical imbalance in my body. So if it's not in my limbs, my torso, my legs, it should be on my brain. Take me to a neurologist, I said to my mom. And my mom says, but we need to go to the first, we need to pass to the clinic. You need to explain this guy, you know, I think there's something relatively wrong with me. And the guy is going to then give you an order to see a neurologist or, you know, an endocrinologist or whatever it is. So we kind of did that. I was still bouncing, like if I just woken up into a birthday party. I was just bouncing with a smile. And another thing that I noticed is that, you know, I'm well known for speaking the truth of what I think, even if it doesn't come as easy or convenient for some other people. But I found myself that I was saying the truth too much. Right during that same period of time, one of my best friends, who confessed to me, not in a loving way, he confessed that he didn't want to get married with his girlfriend, but the pressure on his family was just too much and he had to get married with this girl, and you know, he didn't want that. And I told the guy, do you love her? And he says, like, yeah. And I said, like, you don't look convinced. Do you ever actually, you know, hardly love her? And he said, like, you know, it's free sex, to be honest. And I don't know if I ditch her, if I'm going to ever find somebody else to fuck with me. So you kind of get used to her. And I say, dude, do not get married, because getting used to a person and ain't the same as loving them. I know love doesn't last the entirety of the marriage, but at very least it should last the first part, like a couple months, honeymoon, something like that. If you are describing your future bride with the phrase, you get used to her, it's not something you should do. I said, you know what, like, just don't tell anyone that I told you this. Like, because I already have a lot of problems. A lot is going on inside my head. I don't want to get married, but I have to get married. She wasn't pregnant, if you're asking yourself. There's nothing going on there except social pressure. We've been dating, like, boyfriend and girlfriend for 9 years. 9 years is almost 10. She's busted my balls constantly saying, when are we going to get married? And I'm just trying to avoid it, but it comes a point in which I can't avoid it anymore. So this is going to happen. I don't want it to happen. So what happens when the date in which they were getting married arrived, he invited me to, you know, I didn't went. And I just was the same time in which I was being diagnosed. So I was opening my mouth a lot more than I should have. Not because what I was saying wasn't true or was not what I was thinking or feeling. It was because I was hurting a friend that I already knew had it hard enough. So I opened my mouth and I said, I'm not going to go to your marriage, to your, you know, whatever is civil union kind of thing, because you don't want to go there. And you shouldn't be doing that. And that is not a celebration. That, in this case scenario, it's your funeral. You're going to be stuck in a shit life you don't want to. You should open your mouth before signing any paper saying somebody you get used to, it's your wife. And, you know, I never felt anything for the guy and the guy never felt anything romantically through me. It was just, you know, that much of a good friend. It was like a brother, a real one. And I just, you're fucking yourself up and I'm not going to be there to see it. And the guy was, I need you there. You're my best friend. I need you there because I'm already in deep shit. And I said, you know what, dude? No, because it goes against everything I believe in and I'm not doing it. So the guy kept insisting. And I opened my mouth publicly. It wasn't a good idea. It wasn't a great idea. It was photolog, vlog. I guess MySpace was the thing back there too. But we didn't have. We had photolog. And there was this war between comments in the photolog pages. So, yeah. The thing was that, of course, she wanted to get married, no matter what. She didn't even care if the guy wanted to get married. She wanted to get married, and that was it. So what happened was that, you know, when I exposed what he had told me on that bus stop prior to all of this, because I had no filter at all, because my brain wasn't working properly, I said the truth. And I made a storm of shit coming my way. And to be obvious, still, I was up to fight after 5 days of not sleeping at all. So what happened was that I really got into the biggest catfight of my life on the internet. You know, I had arrived to an age in which, you know, arguing through internet, it wasn't worth it. But back then, I was so, it's like, you know, the same effect that coffee has on me. I was so filled up with a certain hormone that my brain was producing from a tumor that I couldn't shut up. I couldn't fucking shut up. And I knew there was something wrong with me. I should have kept my mouth shut. Just suck up this ceremony and just support my friend, because it was obvious at that point they already had a date for the marriage and I should have been there for him and I wasn't, because I wasn't, you know, thinking clearly. But at the same time, I couldn't stop. You know, I couldn't stop myself. It took me 2 years to overcome that for the most part. And, you know, by then the water was just too sour to go back in to talk to my friend. And I try to make it up. You know, I try when I was rational again, when I was, you know, not screaming the truth, I try to, you know, talk to the guy and say, look, what I said, you know that I believe what I said. You know that I never lied to you, because whatever this has to do with how I behave, I never lied. I was just being too much honest in any case, but I didn't lie. Now, what I'm asking you to do is to forgive me, because I had a brain tumor. I still have one. So, but I had one when I was talking to the guy. I don't know if he's still there or what the fuck is going on there. And, you know, haven't made myself an MRI in a couple of years. You know, pandemic reasons. So the thing is that the guy said, you know what? I know and I understand what you're saying. And I understand any of this was not your fault because you were sick from a medical condition. You have the records, you have your clinical history, you're taking the pills to reduce the tumor, you're, you know, I know this is real. And I know it wasn't your fault to be around screaming, you don't want to get married, dude, don't do it. But I can't forgive you. And that was the nail in the coffin, because if a 10-year-old friend cannot forgive you, no matter what you did, for being sick, and I mind you not, you know, like, I might have been a pester to their marriage, but still, I didn't kill anybody, so, I mean, it wasn't like I just showed up with a flamethrower and just burned the bride, like, you know, that wasn't my style, but the guy saying, I can't forgive you, even though I understand it wasn't on you, was like a deal breaker for me, because if you're my bro, if you're my friend, you're going to understand that I didn't meant to fuck your day with this. I was doing what I thought in my guts was right, which was, you know, getting you out of a shitty marriage that was going to be shitty. What happens, you know, the little I know about them, you know, over the years, was that they have, you know, a couple kids, girl. Ironically, it looks just like the mom. And, you know, whatever. The guy had, you know, they were still married, but she had this attitude of take care of me all the time. Even though I'm an adult, you need to take care of things. So kind of just knowing the guy and knowing her, I kind of know who raised the kid, who was with the kid whenever he was sick, you know, everything. I figure I know. Anyhow, the thing is that your body's going to tell you when something's wrong. If you haven't drink coffee and you haven't slept in 3 days, red flags. Go to the hospital. Perhaps your entire body is fine. There's some imbalance, you know, in your brain or somewhere in between that is causing this. Because if you've been drinking my coffee, yeah, sure, you're not going to sleep perhaps in 5 days. But if you have just drink tea and, you know, you're never feeling tired, it means that your brain is overreactive. Go see a doctor, please. Because I was lucky, kind of. And, you know, they catch the thing in a moment in which, you know, by taking medication, I could try to shrink it into oblivion. But my neurosurgeon was pretty happy. He will just constantly bring it up and said, ah, you know what? Your tumor just looks so good. I could enter your brain through your nose and just pick it up. I was like, no, dude. A, you're not entering into my brain through my nose. I don't know. And you know what? You wanna know something weird too? My neurosurgeon, which is, you know, called Dr. Salvatore, look exactly like the killer from the Jigsaw murders. You know, saw the movies. Now it's a spiral something, but the first ones, Live or Die, the guy like playing those main, it looked less, the fucking same. Look the fucking same. Oh my God. You know, like, I was in front of Jigsaw telling me, you know how much I wish I could just reach your brain through your nose? That is an Arvin. The guy was super cool. You know, don't get me wrong. He was super cool, super professional. The guy was, he knew what he was doing. He was like, those guys are prodigies and kind of know what they're fucking doing. Still, you're not going into my brain through my nose. Ain't gonna happen. But unless you totally have to, unless it's just you have 6 months to live or I can enter your brain. through your nose, your mouth, whatever you choose. And I was like, no, ain't gonna happen. But, well, you know, all in all, that was the thing. Going back to the comment of a little bit, just to finish this off once and for all. Now it's just going on for longer than it should have. But I wanted to shit on the guy so bad, with every single example that I could think of. The thing is, you guys need to accept that your body is the best alarm for anything outside your body and inside your body going on. So if a storm is approaching, chances are you're gonna know. Not because of the smell of the air, not because of the birds, not because of the sky. Your body's gonna know because the atmospheric pressure is going to affect you. It's going to make you feel like shit. This is a thing. And if you ever think that I'm wrong, Google it before you call me on it. Because when you call me on it, I Google it. And if I Google it and turns out that I'm right, you have a video coming. Especially in this time of the month. So I'm going to leave you a couple clips so you can, you know, finish your thinking about some things that apparently people like Billy here just don't know shack shit about, but should at this point in life. So see you later, alligator. Enjoy the little shorter clips.
All right, if you're a woman, I just need you to stop and confirm or deny this, please, because I'm tripping. I was talking to a girl the other day trying to, you know, educate myself on the female body. And she told me that a period will usually last a week. And I'm like, all right. And then she said, but the week before, I get pre-period cramps. And the week after, you get post-period cramps. So I'm like, carry the two. That's 3 weeks. So you're telling me there's only 1 week per month that you're just chilling. You're fighting for your life for 3 quarters of the year. Y'all are built different. I thought I had it bad because I'm lactose intolerant. I drink some milk, my stomach hurts for a couple hours, but then I'm over it. Y'all are literally fighting for your life for the majority of the year. Could never be me. Could never be men. We appreciate you ladies for taking on this burden because we could never do it. Much respect.
Doctors are now saying that the pain we feel when we experience period cramps is equivalent to the pain we feel when we have a heart attack. So we've been enduring this pain for years and just going to work. Buttoning up, going to work. Because we're trained that way. We're trained to be like, it's fine, it's fine. It's pain, but it's nothing. I can endure anything. And we can. But that doesn't mean we have to ignore the way our body feels. And I think these tampon commercials are detrimental. They're always like, oh, you're on your period? Don't let that stop you, girl. Get out there. Go surfing. Go play a sport. Get on a horse. I don't want to do that when I'm not on my period. Stop trying to force me outside. I want to lay down. If you saw a man bleeding uncontrollably and having a 4-day-long heart attack, you wouldn't be like, don't let that stop you. Get on a horse.
The top 4 ingredients in life, in your body, top 4 atoms, in order, hydrogen, oxygen, carbon, nitrogen, those 4 atoms. Do you know what the top ingredients are in the universe? The top 4 chemically active atoms in the universe? Hydrogen, oxygen, carbon, nitrogen.
I am the universe.
Yes! So upon learning that you're not special because you do not contain special ingredients, is the same fact that includes the idea that while we live in this universe, the universe lives within us. We are special because we're the same.
The things that excite you are not random. They are connected to your purpose. So follow them.
That will be all for now. I'll see you in the next video. And fight. if there is a God, by God's sake, just don't be a dick. Bye-bye.